There's an update on the Harvard mess, and it came out just a little bit ago, and I had to respond to it, like a 20-tweet thread or something like that, because it was so ridiculous.
By Harvard update, you're talking about the anti-homeschooling conference originally scheduled by Professor Elizabeth Barthollet at Harvard. That conference then got canceled, many say because of you. and then there was then kind of an Empire Strikes Back moment where Harvard Magazine published new anti-homeschooling opinions. So go ahead. What's the new part?
Yeah, and we recently talked about how she had a full-length interview that came out a week or two ago where she described her presumptive ban that looked a little more like an all-out ban, and she just changed the definition of homeschooling to mean that, well, you only get to homeschool 90% of the time. In my view, you have to take regular classes as well. But she just co-authored a piece that came out, recently, I think yesterday, today, with James Dwyer, who she co-organized that anti-homeschooling propaganda conference with, and a bunch of other people who were supposed to be represented at that conference. And the funny thing here is that the whole point of this article is that she's saying that, you know, the homeschooling crowd is bullying her on the debate about homeschooling. So her and her colleagues at Harvard University and elsewhere started this huge attack on homeschooling with their conference, but then also the Harvard Magazine piece on the risk of homeschooling, where they portray homeschool families to be, you know, child abusers and to be
locked behind bars in a prison cell. We see a girl behind bars there.
So she's they essentially bullied the heck out of homeschoolers and called for a ban on the practice of homeschooling based on these broad brushes that, you know, they're trying to use against the homeschooling community to make them look like bad people. And then once we responded to these articles, she's saying, and her colleagues, James Dwyer and others, that they're being bullied. And what they point to in particular is they say that the tweets from people like Senator Ted Cruz were abusive and bullying tactics, which I don't see how a tweet from Ted Cruz was bullying at all. I don't have it open right now, but all he pretty much said was, look, this is myopic. This is unconstitutional. And he was talking about her ban. And so, like, responding to your presumptive ban or all-out ban on homeschooling, that's not bullying. That's just public debate. And she goes through this, or, you know, the whole group of them go through this and essentially play the victim here. I mean, of course, there are probably some people who said mean things to her and that were out of line. But what Senator Ted Cruz said was not out of line. I don't think I saw anything from Mike Pompeo that was over the line that crosses into, you know, abuse or bullying. It's just they responded to this ridiculous attack on homeschoolers. And I think that's perfectly fine for them to do. And, you know, they go through this and they say, like, oh, we can't believe that, you know, there's so much pushback to our civil data-driven discussion, our academic critique of homeschooling. And, you know, look, come on, your discussion was not data-driven. You used the word some or many 210 times in your 80-page article. You didn't cite statistics to back up your claims. You used fear-mongering. It wasn't an academic critique. But look, this is what has me pumped up, you know, today. Just this whole, and I responded to it on Twitter if anyone wants to go check it out. But it's like a 20-tweet, you know, thread taking on each of these arguments. She even says that, you know, Senator Ted Cruz is trying to suppress public discussion. No, we're not. We're just responding to the presumptive ban, this authoritarian ban. And if anyone is suppressing public discussion, it's their side, because their event was closed off, invitation only featured speakers that were against homeschooling. They had a private event. Our event was public, and we're all talking about this and with public discussion on social media. She's the one that is trying to suppress public discussion. But look, I'm going off the rails here. I could talk about this for hours. There's so much to unpack with this article. A lot of the same things that she argued before that are ridiculous, and not just her, but the other individuals represented on that opinion piece. But I recommend for anyone to go check it out. There's so much to unpack. It's one of these longer form tweet threads. Oh, and I also, real quick, I have a video. I have this video to share for the viewers too. But in 2014, I found this. She essentially argued against her current day ban. Her current argument against the ban is that she says that there are some cases of abuse, and since there are, you know, these rare cases of abuse, we should ban it for everyone. That's her argument. But in 2014, she argued against that line of reasoning when it came to international adoption versus institutionalization. She argued that we should allow international adoption because, you know, the cases of abuse, all, you know, they do happen and it's not perfect, but, you know, we shouldn't punish everybody, she says, for the actions of a few people. So she uses the same arguments that I'm using and the pro homeschoolers are using to say, no, you shouldn't ban it. And she's right here with international adoption. You shouldn't use the exception to prove the rule. You shouldn't generalize using extreme outliers. So just really quickly for the audience, I want to play this video where in 2014, Elizabeth Bartlett totally demolishes her current day argument to ban homeschooling.
I think it's a tiny phenomenon compared to the number of international adoptions. And I think that the people who don't like international adoption, as apparently you do not, and as UNICEF doesn't, regularly love the fact that occasionally scandals show up, because those scandals can be used as a way to help shut down international adoptions.
You're being a bit unfair on me because I've never argued for shutting down international adoption.
Beautiful.
That's great. Great research to find it.
Thank you.
She cites the fact that they were having an academic discussion until mean bulliers like Corey DeAngelis showed up on the scene and Ted Cruz showed up on the scene. What kind of academic pursuit for knowledge bans all opinions that don't agree with the people throwing the conference? How is that some sort of open academic pursuit
it's
of truth?
It's not academic and open inquiry. It's not civil discourse.
It's the opposite.
Right?
It's the opposite.
And, look, she was right here back in 2014. But look, let's just read this, and replacing the word adoption with homeschooling. If you do that, she destroys her own argument. Here's her quote with replacing those words. People who do not like homeschooling love the fact that occasionally scandals show up, because those scandals can be used as a way to shut down homeschooling. There you go. Elizabeth Bartlett, in her own words, destroys her present day argument to ban homeschooling for everyone based on a few cases of rare negative events.
Yeah, and let's also, since we're here anyway, let's acknowledge the elephant in the room, which is that all kinds of school choice opponents use those same tactics. They'll find a charter school scandal somewhere where one charter school maybe is bad, and they'll say, look at this terrible, you know, paradigm. Or they'll find a place, or maybe a place where vouchers are done bad. Say maybe Louisiana law is not the best voucher law, and they'll focus on that. Anecdote to say all state voucher laws are performing, you know, this is a representative of all. So yeah, so that's basically common in the opposition movement for reform.
Yeah, it's totally true. It's like, if Louisiana's voucher program, in your view, isn't working, and if they didn't, in your view, make good decisions about where to spend that voucher money, why should me living in D.C. or, you know, if I were living in California, why should that prevent me from being able to choose schools for my children? You're using, you know, these extreme outliers, to block people's freedoms in general, which is exactly what they're doing with the homeschool discussion here. I just want to play another little short clip from that same interview. She gets so mad about the fact that the lady from Russia Today was using the exception to prove the rule and tried to generalize with extreme cases, which Elizabeth Bartlett was right there. But she even gets so mad about it that she threatens to leave the interview because she's saying, you know, look, I'm not going to do this where you're
That's like shutting down a conference when people want to come who don't agree with you. That's like leaving the interview, shutting down the conference. I see a correlation there.
Here it is. Check it out.
So I'm not going to talk more about Reuters. You can conduct the rest of the interview yourself. I'm not going to conduct an interview in which we focus on a tiny, you know, phenomenon that has nothing to do with the sort of underlying truth of how well kids do when they're kept in institutions as compared to how well they do in international adoption.
Now- hmm. All right.